folks. Welcome to Know Tech Talk with Barb, and that's K-N-O-W, tips, advice, and consulting for your business's IT. I'm your host, Barb Paluszkiewicz, and for those of you taking notes, Paluszkiewicz is spelled the exact way it sounds, Paluszkiewicz. Trust and verify on our website, cdntechnologies.com. What I want to share with you today is how to keep your children safe online from themselves. Are your kids naked online? How to protect your tech-savvy kids from online self-destruction. The struggles of a teenager today are still basically the same as they were decades ago. They're very concerned about image and the way they are perceived by others. The only thing that's new and different with teenagers today, though, is internet, Wi-Fi, and social media. And this is a spoiler alert, everybody, because whether we admit it or not, our teenagers today are managing two separate personas. There's the in-real-life persona, which everyone has and does their best to maintain. But for most teenagers today, there also exists a funnier, sexier, wittier, and even more daring alter ego. And it's this second persona that's in charge of making sure that no matter what, the Instagram and Snapchat content is sensational, sexy, and stage ready. And if you think, not my kid, well, then this episode is perfect for you. And at any time during this show, you can reach out to me at No Tech Talk, and that's K-N-O-W. I, Barbara Paluszkiewicz, am the CEO of CDNTechnologies.com. We are your go-to specialist for preventing you from being a victim of a cybercrime. We are a managed service company here in Mississauga, which is an outsourced IT company, and we provide IT service, IT support, and IT security to local companies here in Mississauga and throughout North America. CDN Technologies has been doing IT since 1989, protecting and preserving data, and we've seen changes, some good, some bad, and some ugly. Keeping your kids safe online is good, and knowing your teen's Instagram and Snapchat handles are a must. So with me here today, I have a very, very technical savvy mom. Her name is Lisa Good of GSG Computers. Lisa is also a cybersecurity expert with over 20 years in the industry world, in the tech world. She's an award-winning, best-selling author and frequent guest on television shows across the U.S. And to top it all off, she has not one, not two, not three. She's got four kids who are living in this digital world. And she is a mom on a mission to help parents protect their kids from online self-destruction. Welcome, Lisa. Woo.
Ooh, it's great to be here, Barb.
Oh, happy to have you. Happy to have another techie mom working in the IT world that has teenagers these days, because it's a crazy world out there. Wouldn't you agree?
Gosh, I'm telling you, the things that our kids know how to do is crazy.
I know. Can you tell me how you got into the IT business in the first place? I know how I did it, but I'm always interested to hear how other women get started in this crazy career.
So my husband and I both loved computers and technology, and like way back, you know, like in the 90s, which the kids say the Jurassic period, way back in the Jurassic period, my husband was working for HCA, which is a large hospital conglomerate here in Nashville. And he said, you know, I think I'm just done with this corporate stuff. I think I just want to be done. And I was working in a corporate position as well. And we said, you know, there's nobody that takes care of the small local businesses that aren't big, you know, corporations. Maybe we should do that. And we launched out. We were like the first IT company in our city in Hendersonville. And as they say, ever since then, you know, the rest is history.
Yeah, and I don't know about you, but do you find that lots of people that you work with and other moms that you know in business or working moms, that they come to you and ask you for IT advice for their kids?
Yes, they do. We get that a lot. Well, I get that a lot, especially mom to mom, because, you know, let's just be honest, in our industry, in our field, we are dominated primarily by men. So it's highly unusual to find a woman in the IT field, although it's getting better. But not only is it hard to find a woman, but it's hard to find one that's a mom that speaks the language and knows the technology and knows the ins and outs, as we say.
Agreed. So why do you think it's important to monitor our kids' digital footprint?
I try to explain to parents that everything kids post online is being cataloged and searched by colleges, future employers, and even future spouses. And a lot of times I'll have the mom say to me, yeah, but you know, my kid, they're on Snapchat, and they say that whatever they post on there gets deleted. And I say, no, it really doesn't. It kind of does, but it doesn't. There's always someone that can take a screenshot of that. And there's always someone with the tools like Barb, yourself, or myself that could probably find everything that their child has posted since they started posting, whether it was deleted or not in their mind. So I really try to hammer that home that everything is following them and will follow them for the rest of their lives.
Agreed. And in addition to that, there's this, what people forget, and I think what kids forget, is there's this backup stream of their experiences that they lived. And as teenagers, you're all over the map. You're going through some like wonderful times and you're going through some crappy times. And since everything is so instant and there's no delay, pause, or time to think about it, kids are like posting everything so quickly and so fast, and there's no time for them to realize the consequences of their actions. I know that most people, like including kids, when they ever take a photo, they want to like share it like right away. And most kids leave their AirDrop on all the time. I know how I feel about it, but do you think that it's a bad idea?
Yes! Oh. You should not leave your AirDrop on. Now, look, I get it. Kids are using AirDrop all the time. They're swapping photos. They're swapping funny videos. And that's okay. But what you should be doing is telling them when they're not using it to turn it off. And the reason is, this is not just mom paranoia coming in here. There's this thing called cyber flashing. And basically, it's where people are sending nude photos or videos to everyone in a 30-foot radius who has their AirDrop on. So this used to only take place in the airports and bus stations, but now it's happening at the movie theater. So I just posted today of, hey, if you're going to be out shopping at the mall this weekend for holiday shopping, or if you're going to go see Frozen 2, if you have an iPhone or your kids have an iPhone, make sure the AirDrop is off, because guaranteed there's going to be someone in that area that's going to say, oh, watch this funny thing I'm going to do. And a lot of times it's kids pranking, but you can actually be charged with a felony if you're caught doing that.
Get out. I had no idea.
Yes, yes.
But I guess that makes sense, because if minors are taking inappropriate photos of themselves, then how is that different from pornography or Phil, what do you call it with little
Pedophilia.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And if you have that on your phone, and even if you share it, you're part of the crime. Like you're contributing to it, which is a big no. Okay.
We had a young man in school that we know that he was forwarded some photos. He did not request them. He was not part of the photos, but you know, as kids do, that's how kids gossip today. They send photos. And he was sent an inappropriate photo, and the principal came in and took everyone's phone. And he was in just as much trouble as the original kids that took the photos and sent the photos.
Makes sense. And I know that as here in Canada, I don't know what the laws are in the U.S., but I know that here in Canada, someone who is an adult, like 18 years or older, is not permitted to send a text or a picture or any type of electronic information to a minor without parent consent. So if someone wanted to send my daughter a picture or my son a picture or send them an email, like if they're a coach for soccer or gymnastics, then essentially I need to be CC'd. They can't email my child or text my child direct. And I think that kids forget that because they get all caught up with Snapchat and they think it's secure. And I know that kids love Snapchat, but it has had some issues with safety lately for kids. So what's your best advice aside from not letting kids have it?
Well, I would say, you know, kids, they love it because it is the most difficult social media to monitor. There is not a monitoring tool that monitors that effectively, which is why they love it. I get it. The problem is that according to law enforcement, that is one of the top three apps that predators use to reach out and contact kids. So I always say, if you're going to play in that world and you're going to let your kids play in that world, you need to limit the visibility in Snapchat so that just strangers can't randomly friend request them. And you should absolutely turn off their Snap maps so that others can't see their location. You know, I said to my son, I'm like, you know, no one needs to know your location 24/7. They don't need to know you're at the mall or that you're driving through Chick-fil-A. You don't need that on. Shut it off. So that's what I tell parents. And then one other tip on the Snapchat, you cannot turn this off, but you can monitor it, and you should, as a parent, the Discover section. Some of the stuff that comes in there is absolutely off the charts. So I would say you probably need to be seeing what your kids are looking at in their Discover, in their stories.
So I guess as parents, we should have the Instagram and Snapchat apps on our phone, especially if our teens and children are using them. And we should learn how to use them too. And we should also know our children's Instagram and Snapchat handles.
Do you
pay attention to that? Like, do you see how many followers that they have and see if there's ever a spike in activity or anything like that?
You should be looking about once a week. A lot of parents go, oh my gosh, are you kidding me? And I always say, well, you know, you could either look at it once a week or in 30 to 60 days, you can get the phone call that your kid just tried to commit suicide from depression and bullying.
Makes sense. Because I know that for Instagram and Snapchat, even if an account is private, you can see the number of followers your child has. And sometimes your child will have multiple Snapchat and Instagram accounts. So it might take some digging. But once you find the account, I feel that it's a good idea to keep an eye on the number of people following your child. And if you notice a crazy amount of followers and the account is private, it could be a sign of an alter ego being in command. And if you notice a large increase in followers in a short time frame, I always think that that's a bit of concern. Like, what's my kid just doing right now that all of a sudden she's like gathered all of this attention towards themselves? So I know for me, when I speak with other moms, I always say, hey, you have to know what their Instagram and Snapchat handles are, just to, like you said, to make sure they're not in any real danger. You don't have to police everything.
Right.
And go
another
ahead.
Another good idea is to get with another parent or two or three moms that you know that have like a similar philosophy that, hey, you know, they're going to play in this world and that's okay, but we just want to keep an eye and try to keep them out of danger. If you have two or three other moms that you know, you guys can all be looking, because probably the statistics say 6 out of 10 have those second accounts that parents don't know about. I would probably say it's probably 8 out of 10 kids have those secret second accounts, you know, the alter ego accounts that you don't know about. And if you've got two or three of you looking for each other's kids, someone's going to find them eventually.
It's a new neighborhood these days, because before, you know what, people would go outside, they play on the court. You know what, they play at the end of the... Phil, you're laughing at me.
You mean the cul-de-sac on the road, okay, hockey, maybe basketball?
Oh, you lived in a fancy neighborhood. I lived on a court.
I lived on an avenue.
And essentially, you know, as long as you were there, it didn't, like, you know what, the crossing guard, the the mailman, you know what, someone's grandmother.
The supervisor at school.
That's exactly it. Like, they would always be, they would always tell you if you were not being very well-mannered or if you were out of line. So you kind of need that now in a different forum, because I know that there are a lot of secret apps that are out there that hide all of your apps that you have. So, you know, Lisa, perhaps you can explain what a secret app is and how do you know if your child has one?
So basically, a secret app functions just like it says, whether it could be a calculator, a music app, a calendar. I've even seen a navigation app. And you can use it as the app functions. If it's a navigation app, it really is a navigation app, but it has this sinister dark side. The kids can put in this password, and it opens up this whole separate side of the app. They call it the vault. It opens up the vault, and they can hide photos, phone calls, videos, text messages, and one of the scariest things, they can hide their browsing history, where they're surfing on the web on their phone. So you can't see that. You would not ever be able to see that. So I tell parents the quickest and easiest way to find out if they have a secret app is go to the app store on their phone and type in Vault app with a V, or if you type in hide photos, and then when the results come up, just start scrolling. And you're looking for anything that's got the little cloud on Apple or that has, you know, installed on an Android. You want to see if there's anything they have installed. If you find something, you want to sit down and have a chat with your child. Don't try to break into the app. A lot of these apps have a break-in feature that as you're trying to punch in numbers, it's taking your picture and it's either emailing or texting whatever contact your child put into that app, letting them know that mom is trying to break into my stuff. And you're not going to get very far in communication with your child that way. So the best thing to do would be to sit down with them and say, hey, I know what this is. I want you to open it and show me what's in there. And don't try to fool me with the decoy password. I already know it has one. So put the real password in and let's talk about this calmly.
I would love that. You know what, but with my luck, if I did that, my kids would be like laughing at me. They're just like, oh, look at mom's face. She's so mad.
I always say you have to go, probably as an adult, if you find something like this, you should go into your closet and, you know, yell, scream, whatever you have to do. Because, yeah, a lot of times parents, especially us moms, my kids always say, Mom, you have the angry eyebrows, even though you say you're not angry.
I have the flaring nostrils.
See? So our kids know how to read us. So you might have to do a little prep before you do that, but you absolutely have to do it.
Do you think you should prep with hard liquor or wine?
I'd go with wine.
Okay. All right. So another thing that happens is that I know that when kids first start getting involved in social media, it's usually just an exchange of little thoughts and little feelings. And eventually it does move to recording everything in real time where anyone can keep a backup and everything going. But usually once that begins to happen and people begin to comment, sometimes bullying comes into play. Like, cyberbullying is a prevalent issue today. Is there anything that we can do to ensure that our kids have the emotional intelligence or to not participate or just know how to say no online?
Yes. One of the key things to do before you give your kids the social media is sit down with them and show them some social media posts. Good and bad is what I would do, and say, what do you see is wrong with these posts? How would you have handled this situation? So this way you're kind of training them before you just give them, like a bike, you know, you're training them with the wheels on before you take the wheels off and give them their own social media account. Then the other thing I always say is it's really good to remind kids, once you give them the social media, that others can't read the tone or get the joke on social media. It's really hard. That's one of the downsides of this form of communication is you might be saying something really funny or being a little sarcastic to your friend, but it doesn't come across that way. It comes across as mean, spiteful, or that you're just outright being a bully. And I don't know about how it is in Canada, but here in the U.S., if a parent or a teacher sees anything like that, they're supposed to report that to the school and to the police. So it's a really serious issue, and I just say you have to remind your kids, even 15, 16-year-olds need to be reminded. And I always, what I say to my kids is, you should treat people the same way online as you want to treat people offline. So if you wouldn't say that to someone's face, face-to-face, you should not type that in a keyboard. And the best policy is if your grandmother was sitting there reading that, would you be comfortable looking at your grandmother eye-to-eye after she read what you just typed in?
You know what? Those are very good points, because I think that lots of times when kids are young, they struggle with the transition, and it impacts them with their development. I know one time we had company over, and so I hooked my kids up, and they're each playing Minecraft, and they're building their own world. And next thing you know it, they start arguing in the Minecraft world. And I have company over, and like I'm like priding myself how well-behaved and well-mannered my children are. But then next thing you know it, someone sets someone's house on fire and knocks down a wall. Do your kids play Minecraft?
They don't play Minecraft, but they play this other game. It's called Ark, Survival of Something. And yes, someone stole something from somebody, or somebody's house caught on fire. And the next thing you know, yes, the room is on fire.
That's exactly what happened. My two lovely little children that are like all dressed up because we're having a dinner party, get into this argument in this cyber world, in this Minecraft world. So eventually I'm just like, okay, go outside and play. Outside, the argument continues. Like, the windows are open. You did this. I was like, oh my gosh, of all times for this to happen. Like, you know, we've talked about this. I was like, okay, I didn't do a good job here. So then sure enough, I have to say, okay, everybody, you know, what happens in the cyber world stays in the cyber world, but it really doesn't. They have to know how to transition into the real world, because this is a part of our life, or a part of their lives.
Right. Society doesn't have separation like that.
That's exactly right. It wasn't, they didn't have it in the 80s. They didn't have it in the 90s. This is something new to deal with. And I just remember thinking, oh my gosh, this is embarrassing.
They're probably going to set actual fires to each other's houses now.
You know what? It was all good until, you know what, profanities got used. And I was just like, really? No. Like, why? Why are you escalating it?
Over a video game.
Right.
Well, you know, someone blew up someone's house. Like, I'm sure that between like religion and wars, this stuff happens all over the world.
I took
life.
The secret sword of wonder, and now I'm invincible.
Yeah. Well, and you know what's really? And we're laughing and joking, and it is funny, and it truly is. And we always should keep a sense of humor. But this is what's really sad to me, and this will be like the last point I make is that, you know, when we were kids. And let's be honest, did you do and say some really stupid things? Like that if people could read or hear or see what you said, you would be like, oh my, I cannot believe I did that. Right?
Well, and I still do it.
Well, I mean, but you probably don't do it online.
Well, I try not to.
But our kids, unfortunately, you know, they don't have that freedom or that luxury because they post everything instantaneously. You know, it's like, you know, what comes into the brain comes out of the mouth and through the fingers into the keyboard. And unfortunately, you know, what a 15-year-old thinks and says when they're 21 changes, and when they're 25, it changes again. But unfortunately, the cataloging of all the stuff that they've done, that just follows them. And people don't look at it like, oh, they were only 15 at that time, or, oh, he was only 21, and, you know, he's in college, and he just turned 21, and of course he's stupid, because when you're 21, everyone's stupid, and we say stupid things. But that's not how people look at it. We just had a 25-year-old lose a job over something that he tweeted when he was 18.
You know what? Our prime minister didn't get fired for going blackface, and that was like in his college days and things like that. That was over 20 years ago.
But it is a good point, though, you guys are making, because he did that in 2001 when the internet wasn't really as prominent as it is today.
Exactly.
And there wasn't social media either, which meant that it didn't spread like wildfire on that day.
That's right. Exactly. It was just a photo, but right. then it's a photo that someone scanned and uploaded and was like a whole like, ha, so it does catch
somehow
up with you.
Somehow people don't forgive or forget like they used to.
Yes.
So, Lisa, you've traveled. You've been on TV shows. You have a wonderful book. What is the most important thing that you've ever learned? You have four kids. Like, you know, like you've learned a lot, but what's the most important thing?
The most important thing I would say is technology in and of itself is not bad and evil. It's what you do with it. And as a parent, you cannot just hand over these things and say, here you go, have a great time. You have to be actively engaged as a parent, and there's no reason to be afraid, and there's no reason to be scared, even though they're smarter than you. The key is you have to be actively engaged as a parent, and you have to have open lines of communication with your kids. I would say that's probably the most important.
Makes a lot of sense. So what is one takeaway that you can give our listeners before we sign off? How can they get a hold of you? How can they get your book?
They can get the book at Amazon.com, or they can go to YourKidsSecretLife.com. I've got free resources for parents on there, and you can watch media of me on TV if you're interested in seeing some of my other segments, but that's where everything is, YourKidsSecretLife.com.
Awesome, YourKidsSecretLife.com. Thank you, Lisa, for taking the time to chat with us here today. I loved all the points that you brought up about the social media and the Vault app and the Hide the Photo app, because it's all about keeping our kids safe online from themselves. You know, we always think about the predators, but we have to keep them safe from themselves for their future. So I suggest to everyone out there that if you're keeping an eye out, focus on protecting your kids against the real dangers that are out there, not policing every move your teen makes, and try not to be too controlling. A post that makes you roll your eyes or has typos or sounds dumb to you or uses off-colored language, let it be. Pay attention to the serious stuff, the hidden stuff. So I'm proud to say that CDN Technologies is a managed service provider, and we do provide business continuity plans for keeping our customers safe. And in the event you need to get a hold of us, call me, 905-542-9759, or visit us at cdntechnologies.com, or reach out to me direct at barbarap.tv.
Trip on a bus that I didn't know. Met a girl selling drinks at the disco.